We come into the presence of the Most High. We come into the presence of the depth of meaning. We come into the presence of that which awes and humbles us, and that which enlivens our bodies and our spirits. We come to be alone together in the presence of sisters and brothers in the peace of this place. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in the sight of all that is lovely and loving, of all that is gentle and brave.
My name is Harvey Nystrom, and on behalf of the Board of Trustees, I welcome you all to All Souls Church, a place where we come together in unity to deepen souls and alive, enlivened spirits. If you're visiting us, we extend a special welcome to you and hope that you'll stay after the service for conversation and refreshments. It's nice to see some new faces here today, so please stay and get to know us. We build our church on a foundation of love and covenant with one another to freely explore our values and honor our diversity as a source of mutual strength, to accept responsibility for our individual acts and promote justice and peace, to celebrate the joys of discovery, embracing the fullest measure of our humanity, to communicate with kindness and support, to serve with compassion and commitment, to openly share our laughter and tears, and to show reverence for the mind in all that is.
As the choir is assembling, I'd like to tell you that we'll be singing this twice. First in English, so you understand what it's about, and secondly in Latin, because it's so beautiful in Latin. And that's the way Casals wrote it. He wrote this for the 25th anniversary of the UN.
Oh.
they were running around, and all of a sudden, Jody hit the table too hard as she was running past it, where this really fancy, old, like antique vase was sitting on this table. And guess what happened to it? Yes, it fell off and broke. This treasure of her mother's that she knew she was in big trouble. So she ran the other way real fast. But of course, her mother was in the other room, and she heard what happened, and she kind of even saw what happened. And she called to Jody. Jody, come back here. And Jody came back. And she said, what happened to this vase? And Jody said, it was my brother. You ever do anything like that? No. You'll admit it. Yeah, she said it was my brother who broke the vase. And her mother, being a very wise Unitarian Universalist mother, said, are you sure? She said, do you know I can see things that you don't think I can see? And Jody broke down and she admitted, yes, I did. I broke the vase. I am so sorry. And her mother, of course, was very disappointed in the vase. She was also very disappointed in Jody, because not only did Jody break the vase by running around in the house, which she knew she wasn't supposed to be doing in the first place anyways, but then she even lied about it. And that was a big disappointment to Jody's mother. So Jody's mother said to her, how do you think you should be punished? What do you think we should do? And Jody, she was just horrified. She didn't know. She, send me to bed without dinner? I don't know. And Jody's mother told her, Jody, you know, I love that vase. You know, you're not supposed to run in the house. And you know, I'm very disappointed. I'm very sad. Do you know what she said? Jody, I'm not going to punish you for this. I think you feel as bad as I do. And Jody, I'm going to show you mercy. Do you know about mercy? Have you ever heard the word? Yeah? What does that mean? What's Jody's mother doing? Showing Jody mercy. Yeah, well, she's not giving her a punishment. Yeah, she's not punishing her for the broken vase or for the lie. She's letting her go. And she's letting Jody's conscience work on her instead. So do you think Jody's mother is a good mother? Yeah. Yeah. Do you wish your mother would show mercy more often? Yeah. It's really, really good when used sparingly. When we used appropriately, mercy can really help our consciences to bloom. I invite you to join me in a spirit of prayer or meditation. In this quiet moment, we seek our higher self, the person we would become, more patient and forbearing, more forgiving, more compassionate and understanding, more courageous before the wrongs that must be righted. Here may we acknowledge our debt to the good and just from whom we have received benefits. Here may we be moved to revere the ideals of love and mercy. Here, let us hold a mirror to our lives that we may acknowledge our failures and mercifully forgive ourselves. Here, let us leave some of our burdens and hurts, our feelings of unworthiness, our grudges. With us here, may the lonely find friends, the defeated be encouraged, and those tempted to stray from their path be reminded of their loyalty. And in the warmth of this community, may each find a need supplied. So would we dwell together in peace, seek the truth in love, and be of help to one another. And let us pause for a few moments in silent reflection.
This morning's reading comes from The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. It is Portia's famous monologue. The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. 'Tis mightiest in the mightiest. It becomes the throned monarch better than his crown. His scepter shows the force of temporal power, the attribute to awe and majesty, wherein doth sit the dread and fear of kings. But mercy is above this sceptered sway. It is enthroned in the hearts of kings. It is an attribute to God himself. And earthly power doth then show likest God's when mercy seasons justice. The life of this liberal religious community is supported by the generosity of all who worship here. United by our common humanity and inspired by heartfelt compassion, we can make the world a better place. For the month of September, our Social Action Committee has selected the Windham County Safe Place Child Advocacy Center to share our Sunday offering. Alyssa Todd will now tell us more about the mission of the Advocacy Center.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here today. My name is Alyssa Todd, and I am the Executive Director and Forensic Interview Specialist at the Safe Place Child Advocacy Center, which is located in downtown Brattleboro. The Safe Place is a 501c3 nonprofit organization that was founded in 2010 to serve the families and children of Windham County who may have experienced sexual or serious physical abuse. A child's disclosure of abuse is only the beginning of a long and complicated process that involves both ensuring the child's safety as well as how to protect our community. The goals of Safe Place are to make this experience as comfortable as possible for children by offering a neutral and child-friendly safe space for children to be interviewed, help families with their healing process, and support an effective team approach amongst the service providers involved in investigating these cases, which includes law enforcement, child protective services, medical personnel, mental health professionals, and prosecution. Childhood sexual abuse is a prevalent issue that is rarely spoken about. It is estimated that 1 in 4 girls and 1 in 6 boys will be sexually abused before they turn 18. And of these cases, 80% will go unreported. Incidents of sexual abuse are rarely committed by strangers. In fact, less than 10% of child sexual abuse cases are committed by strangers, which means that over 90% of child sexual abuse is committed by family members or other adults that are known to the child. Sexual abuse happens to members of all races, religions, socioeconomic backgrounds, and its impact on an individual can be lifelong. By helping families and children get the help and support that they need, we can minimize this impact and re-empower them to become not victims, but survivors. Prior to the founding of Safe Place, children were interviewed in their homes, at school, daycares, in hospitals, and at police departments. At Safe Place, children are interviewed in our child-friendly rooms while protective parents and guardians wait nearby. Our interviews are conducted by trained professionals, including myself, and are video recorded. These video recordings mean that children often do not have to be re-interviewed, and in some cases, which result in criminal charges, the video recordings can be used in lieu of child's testimony on the witness stand. The Safe Place offers continued support to families through resources and service referral, and we strive to raise awareness in our community about child sexual abuse. There's a bumper sticker that I've seen around town that says, "Children should be seen, heard, and believed." And this is, I think, a nice summation of what we at the Safe Place are working to do for our community, give children a voice. We appreciate the support of all of you here at the All Souls Church, and on behalf of us working together at Safe Place, I want to thank you all for your generous donation. I also would like to thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today about our organization and our mission.
Thank you, Alyssa. As the ushers pass the offering plates, let us all show the quality of mercy as we give generously to keep the children of Windham County safe.
Seems like an almost
un-American value. Maybe it's something we left behind when we left the old country. On the contrary, the spirit of America seems to be an eye for an eye. Many Americans, most even, support capital punishment, even though most religions teach that it is simply wrong to kill, and that two wrongs don't make a right. There's a passion around making criminals pay for their crimes that feels like vengeance or retaliation. And while it's understandable to want revenge when we've been hurt, or for instance, when a loved one has been killed, we want them to pay. We want revenge. We want justice, at least. And yet, that part of us that wants revenge is not our most noble side. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. The well-known biblical quote suggests that such punishment will be meted out by other forces, and it's not ours to do. In the New Testament book of Romans, where this quote is found, it also says, "Bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Recompense to no man evil for evil, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good." Well, that's easier said than done. I myself have found myself as a child when I felt unfairly hurt by my sister, I would plot to make her pay. It seemed like she was always getting away with hurting me and never got punished for it. So I decided I needed to take justice into my own hands. And I would go into her room with the idea of being destructive, and even envision myself sweeping everything off her bureau onto the floor. But you know what? I would chicken out. I would chicken out because I knew I would get in trouble. I wish I could say it was because of something more noble. But no, it was simple fear of punishment. Oh, mercy is more noble than that. It's closer to forgiveness. In both cases, someone has injured us and deserves our anger, and deserves some punishment. But whereas forgiveness is letting go of the anger, mercy is letting go of the punishment. The Stoic philosopher Seneca tells a story about the Roman Emperor Augustus finding out that a man was conspiring to kill him. Augustus didn't want to kill the man named Cinna, but felt that Cinna had to pay for his crime. But so many had already tried to assassinate him. So many had already been killed. Finally, his wife Livia said to him, "So far, severity has done no good. Now try how mercy will succeed. Pardon Lucius Cinna. He has been detected and can no longer harm you. He can advance your reputation." So Augustus summoned Cinna to a private council and said to him, When I found you in my enemy's camp, Cinna, I saved you and allowed you to retain your patrimony undiminished. Today, you are rich and prosperous. When you asked for a priesthood, I gave it to you, passing over many candidates whose fathers had fought at my side. And after I have done these things for you, you have decided to kill me. Cinna, of course, protested, but Augustus laid out what he knew. He said, Cinna, again, I give you your life. Before it was to an enemy, and now to a conspirator and assassin. From this day forward, let us begin to be friends. Let us compete to see which shows better faith, I in giving you your life, or you in owing it to me. Afterwards, he bestowed the consulship upon him unsolicited, complaining that he had not shown the courage to be an active candidate. Thereafter, Augustus found Cinna to be devoted and loyal, and he was named his sole heir. In the reading, Shakespeare's character Portia says of Mercy that it blesseth him that gives and him that takes. It not only benefits the recipient of mercy, but the one who bestows it as well. We always have something to gain by being merciful, though it's usually intangible. Certainly, it can have the effect of creating loyalty, as it did for Augustus. In the well-known Aesop's fable about the lion and the mouse, the exercise of mercy and the resulting loyalty has a direct and concrete benefit. Do you remember the story? Because once when a lion was asleep and a little mouse began running up and down on him, this soon wakened the lion, who placed his huge paw upon him and opened his big jaws to swallow him. Pardon, O King, cried the little mouse. Give me mercy this time. I shall never forget it. Who knows but what I might be able to do you a good turn sometime. Well, the lion was so tickled at the idea of the little mouse being able to help him that he lifted his paw and let him go. Some time after, the lion was caught in a trap, and the hunters, who desired to carry him alive to the king, tied him to a tree while they went in search of a wagon to carry him on. Just then, the little mouse happened by, and seeing the sad plight in which the lion was, he went up to him and soon gnawed away the ropes of the king of beasts. Was I not right? Said the little mouse. And in the children's story I told today, we have little Jody who got in trouble and was shown mercy by her mother. Do you think she got let off too easily? Most mothers would impose a punishment. Probably. And most children certainly expect a punishment. But her mother was trying mercy this time. And there's a quality about mercy that can be very valuable in teaching a lesson. The recipient of mercy certainly benefits in that he or she escapes a deserved punishment. But there is a less tangible benefit as well. Mercy heightens rather than dilutes the pangs of conscience. Mercy heightens rather than dilutes the pangs of conscience. when we know we deserve punishment, and instead we receive mercy, it does more to make us change our ways than any punishment could. And I know this from personal experience. And I do hesitate to tell this story because I don't want you thinking I'm a lawbreaker. But one time I was stopped by a cop for speeding. And I do have to admit that this wasn't the first time. And in fact, I had gotten speeding tickets before. But it apparently hadn't stopped me from exceeding the speed limit. Well, seeing those blue lights behind me as I wait for the cop to come back with my license, I prayed with a fervency I have rarely experienced. It was a simple prayer, full of humility, consisting of a heartfelt, sincere promise to slow down if I could only not get a ticket. And now I don't believe it was whatever God I may have been praying to, but the good police officer who showed me mercy. He gave me a warning only, and my heart expanded with such gratitude that I was happy to go the speed limit from that day forward. Except when I forget. Or I'm really, really late. In Portia's speech, Shakespeare suggests that our power is most like God's when mercy seasons justice. Traditionally, in Christianity, God is often referred to as merciful, though that same God also condemned many people to eternal punishment. In contrast, our universalist God is a truly merciful God, because the universalists believe that everyone would be saved from such punishment. Our founding doctrine of the universalists is universal salvation. Everyone will be saved. Nobody is condemned to eternal hellfire and brimstone. So, what that means in non-theistic terms is that instead of requiring people to hold on to their guilt and shame for all their misdeeds, the universalists brought a freeing message that people are lovable no matter what they do. Guilt and shame are lousy motivators. Unconditional love, on the other hand, provides wonderful motivation to do and to be good. Love saves. Mercy can prick the conscience in the way that punishment never can, and can transform those it is bestowed upon and those who bestow it. I believe that justice should be served, but I also believe with the Scottish Justice Secretary that outrage cannot and should not be a basis of who we are, the values we seek to uphold, and the faith and beliefs that we seek to live by. We can seize injustice with mercy whenever it's in our power to inflict punishment or to choose to withhold punishment. We can serve justice, but we can also show mercy. May it be so. The tradition here to form a closing circle as everyone takes hands in a big circle around the room. I invite you to join hands. So let us go forth with hope and strength. May we proclaim the power of life's meaning with deeds of justice and mercy. And may we remain together in spirit until the hour we meet again.